So, as mentioned, now we will be discussing about frequent pattern growth trees. Okay, so this is in kind of continuation with our previous session where we have been discussing about a priori algorithm and association root mining. Okay, so I believe you still remember all the basic concepts regarding item set, support, confidence, everything. Okay, so I believe that, and then based on the assumption, I'm moving on to the next concept of pattern growth approach. Okay, so here, when you see here in the table, we have transaction IDs and the items bought for each of the transaction. And then we have, like, you know, got the frequent items. So I believe how you are able to get this frequent items, this was well explained in a previous class. Okay. And then we are assuming our minimum support is 3. Okay. So given that, we'll be, like, you know, constructing a frequent pattern tree from this transaction database. Okay, so this frequent pattern growth adopts a divide and conquer strategy. Okay, it is otherwise called as FP tree, which and this retains the item association formation information. Okay, this is a special kind of a projected database. It's kind of a conditional database which is associated with one frequent item or a pattern fragment, which mines each database separately. For each of this pattern fragment, only its associated data sets needs to be examined. Okay, you don't have to, like, you know, look into the whole thing. So it reduces size of the data sets to be searched along with the growth of the patterns to be examined. Okay, let's see how this works right now. Okay, so first we'll be, like, you know, scanning the database and then find the frequent item set in a single item part. Okay, so we got it here and we are, like, sorting this according to the descending order and we are creating a F list, frequent list. Okay, and then after creating this, we have already discussed how this is, like, you know, right. Okay, right now we'll be, like, you know, discussing only the third step of constructing the frequent pattern tree. So I believe we have explained this clearly also in the previous session. So here, from the root, we got F, which is repeated 4 times, and then we have C, A, M, P. So for the first ordered frequent item, we got the tree. F, C, A, M, P. So all is, like, you know, repeated, occurred once. So it should be, like, 1 first. Ignore the number we have right now. So it's the final number. And then we have F, C, A, B, M. So we have F, C, A. So from A, we have another branch, B, and from B to M. So here it's 1. So here it becomes F is 2, C is 2, A, 2. Okay. And then we have another transaction, F, B. So F becomes 3, B becomes 1. And then we have C, B, P. So from the root node, we are getting C, B, and P. All is occurring once. And then we have F, C, A, M, P. So we have already F, C, A, M, and P. So this item is kind of occurring again. Okay, it occurred twice. Okay. So F is occurred 4 times, C is, like, you know, 3 times here and 1 time here. So it becomes 4. A is 3 times. B is, like, 1 time here, 1 time here, and 1 time here. Totally 3 times. M is 2 times here and 1 time here. P is 2 times at the end and 1 time at the end here. Okay, so that's how we construct a frequent pattern tree from a transaction database. So here the first scan of the database is the same as the a priori algorithm that we have already discussed, which derives a set of frequent items and their support counts. So here, since we are having support count as 2, we are eliminating the rest of the things, and then we are ordering in the descending support item count, and then we are forming this tree. Hope are able to understand this. To facilitate the tree traversal, an item header table is built so that each item points to its occurrence in the tree via a chain of the node of links. So this is our node of link. So here we see this link, right, that we have been looking at. Okay. So this way, the problem of mining frequent patterns of the data, this is transformed into a mining of the frequent pattern tree. Okay, so start from each of the frequent length one pattern, we are constructing this conditional pattern base. Okay, so this is your suffix pattern, after that becomes a conditional pattern. Okay, the pattern growth is achieved by the concatenation of the suffix pattern with the frequent patterns generated from the conditional FP tree. Okay. So here we are we can also work on the conditional pattern base and tree. Maybe we'll discuss that in the next slides. So before that, we can just see how we can just form subsets. So we know already the frequent list is FCA BMT. So we can just try to identify the pattern with all our subsets with which has only P, the patterns which has P. And sometimes we can also check with patterns having M but not P. So it goes on. You can just then you can try to check on the patterns having B but not M and P. The patterns containing A but not B and P. So it goes on. So here, and then you can check out the patterns containing C but not the rest of the four things. And then we can just check out the patterns containing M. So that's how if you're able to look into this, you will be able to create a lot of subsets. Okay, so this pattern pattern finding technique is going to be completely useful so that you don't have to do it again and again. Okay, so we'll be looking into the creation of conditional pattern bases. So I believe you got how this has been done. So we are trying to check the pattern basis. So with C, F has occurred 3 times. So with C, the count is 3, right? So F has occurred 3 times with C. For A, FC has occurred 3 times. You have to take the count here. And for B, FCA, this pattern has occurred once, and I see B here, so F has occurred once, and I see here, so C has occurred once. So that's why FCA once, F once, and C one. For M, FC occurred twice. And here I have M, so FCA B occurred once. Okay, so for P, FCA M occurred twice, because the number is 2 here, and CB has occurred once because it's 1 here. So we are able to find out the conditional pattern base. Okay, for each of the items in our frequent table. Okay, so let's look into the pattern base. Okay, so let's take it. M conditional pattern base now. Okay, so for M we have FCA twice, FCA B once, right? So F has occurred 3 times. So here it occurs twice, and here it is occurred once. So totally F has occurred 3 times, C 3 times, A3 times. And B we are not using. So we have, because our minimum support is 2, so it should be greater than 2. So here we are using this, and then with this we can able to, like, you know, create patterns related to M as M, FM, CM, AM. And then we can see FCM, FAM, CAM, and FCAM. So we are trying to, like, you know, create a pattern for the M, conditional FP tree. Hope you got how we got this. So you can just, you can check in here as well. FM, CM, AM, FCM, FAM, CAM, FCAM, the whole thing. Okay. So likewise, we have to be, like, you know, doing it for the other items as well. Okay. So for AM, FC has occurred thrice. So F is 3, C is 3 times. For CM, F has occurred 3 times. So it is F3 is only the conditionality. From the root, you just have F3. And for CAM, F has occurred 3 times. Because you remember this tree, right? So we have FCA3. For conditional pattern AM, we got FC thrice. For conditional pattern CM, we got F thrice. For CAM, we got F thrice. Okay. So we are trying to mine each of our conditional FP tree here. So why do we have to go for this FP structure? Because it is going to be a complete one. I told you, because we are, nothing is going to be left out. No, all the frequent patterns will be completely mined. Okay. So the whole database will be like scanned. So this is where people always go for FP tree structure. And it is a compact one. So all this information will be, like, you know, relevant information will only be stored, and the item which is not in the pattern will be completely taken off, and it is arranged in the descending order so that you'll be able to understand which occurs more, and you're also able to understand the frequency as well. Okay. And always the number or the count is lesser than the original transaction count, so that we know it is the correct frequency number. See, here always we get, you know, 3. Maximum we get 4. 4 is a count. So there were, like, you know, 5 transactions in the original database, remember? There were, like, only 5 transactions. So maximum frequency, it is just 4. So it means the frequency hit is correct. Okay, so there is a process which is being followed to, or a method is being, like, followed to identify this frequent pattern growth trees. The first, we have to, like, construct our conditional frequent pattern base, and then we have to create a conditional frequent pattern tree. And then we have to, like, repeat this for the whole thing again until we get the FP tree empty. Until we get the only one part. That's what we have been doing. Right. See, first we created the frequency hit table, and then we created a tree, and then we got the conditional pattern base for M. We got the conditional pattern base, and then we were able to create a complete conditional fragment pattern tree for this. And then we are kind of repeating the whole thing for all the items until we get the tree which has nothing except the root. See, so this we have been doing it only for M. So we have to be doing this for all the other items as well. Okay. So how this frequent pattern growth will work in a bigger data set? If you have a transaction which is, like, we have been talking about the transaction which is, like, you know, very less, just 5 transactions. Just think about the transaction which is going to be, like, in in thousands or in millions. Take a Walmart or Flipkart. Imagine the transactions there. So it's going to be huge. So if you're going to like mine data in such bigger data sets, so you have to like, you know, look into the performance of your machine, the runtime algorithm. So when you compare frequent growth with the a priori algorithm that you have discussed already, so when you have the threshold in the x-axis and then runtime in the y-axis, so this is our a priori runtime. So it is kind of little higher when compared to the frequent pattern growth. So when your threshold percentage is kind of increasing, your runtime is decreasing. Okay, so if you have a higher threshold, obviously you don't have to mine very minimal frequent patterns, right? So always it is ideal to have a, you know, higher thresholds for support. So when you compare it here, here also with the tree projection algorithm, so we can see frequent pattern is kind of like, you know, doing better than the tree algorithms. Okay. So as I told you, frequent pattern growth approach follows a divide and conquer method. So it's one of a very big added advantage, because here they'll be able to like, you know, understand why there is a pattern. So they just decompose each of the item set, and then it identifies with which other items it is like, you know, associated with. So it able to like, you know, work on the in the big data set by focusing on a smaller pattern itself. Okay, so it will be like searching on a very smaller database even though it has a bigger data set. Okay, so and you don't have to like, you know, work on candidate generation, right? So in the a priori algorithm, you don't have, you were working on candidate generation and candidate testing and all, remember? But here you don't have to like, you know, do that, so that it reduces the size of the candidate sets, so that you'll be able to like, you know, gain good performance. Earlier, the a priori algorithm, you were able to like, you know, scan the entire database and check a large set of candidates by pattern matching. But here, you don't have to do this. It is like, you know, that method is very costly for because you have to go over each of the transaction in the database to determine the support of the candidate item sets. Here, you don't have to do that. Here, you are actually like, you know, compressing your database with a tree structure. Okay. Okay, so there's one more concept where we'll be like, you know, mining the patterns by using a vertical data format. Okay, so far we have been like discussing about only the horizontal data format, because we had transaction ID and items. Remember, I'll show you the example again. When you see the table here, we got transaction ID and the items one. But right now, in the vertical one, we'll be seeing the items in bot here, and will be all the transactions will be grouped together. Okay. So that is another approach of mining patterns in the vertical data format. As I told you, I got the item set and the transaction set here. So we are like keeping up the minimum support test two as always. And then here we are grouping up the items at 1 and 2, 1 and 3, 1 and 4, 1 and 5. Remember what we used to do in a priori algorithm, right? So 1 and 2, we got a combination of T100. So T400 is here, yes. T500, no, so we have to omit this. T700, we don't have it here. T800, yes. T900, yes. So we got only four same items, same transactions here for item 1 and 2. So we got four transactions. For 1 and 3, we got there's no 100. is no 400. Yeah, we got 500, we got 700, we got 800, 900. So 500, 700, 800, 900. Okay. So we can check it. Item 1 and item 3. We don't have 100, 400, no, 500. We got 500 here. 700, yes. 800, yes. 900, yes. Sorry, we already checked this, right? So we have to check it with item 4. So we got only 200 and 400. So the common item is T400 for I and info. So like this, you do it for a whole thing. So item 1 is compared with 2, 3, 4, 5. 2 is compared with 3, 4, 5. Item 3 is compared with 4, 5. Item 4 is compared with 5. So we got so many transaction IDs, which are common in both of the item sets. So we have to eliminate I 1 and 4, item set 3 and 5, because we have a minimum support as 2. So it should be equal to or greater than 2. So we have to eliminate this. And then we are going for 3 item sets in the vertical data format. So we have to do with item 1, 2, and 3. So we got 100 is not available here, 4 is not here, but you got 800 and 900. It's for item 1, 2, and 3, we got T, 800, 900. So you can't compare with item 4 because it's taken out because minimum support is less than 2. Yeah. Sorry, the item set is, transaction set is less than 2. So you got to do with the item 5. So we got T 100, T 800. So we tend to do this, and then we got only with minimum support 2, we got only 2 different item set combinations with the occurrence of more than 2 transaction ID set. Okay. And then you can just proceed with this usual things that we have discussed earlier. Okay, so here instead of using a horizontal data format, we're using a vertical data format. This is also one of the approach. Okay, next we'll be discussing about mining the closed items through this frequent pattern work approach. Okay. So from the set of closed frequent items, we can easily derive the set of frequent items and their support. Okay. So, but how are we going to mine the closed frequent items? There's a named approach, which would be to first mine the complete set of frequent items and then remove every frequent item set that is a proper subset of and carries the same support as an existing frequent item set. Okay, this is kind of little costlier method. For example, in this method, we would have to derive a frequent item set and then we have to go for a identify the proper subset. Okay. So there is a process. There are different methods followed to mine your closed item set. The first one is through item set merging. Okay, so if you have 2 items, there are a lot of items. For example, if Y item is appearing in all the occurrence of X items, which means if some people has buying an item Y, they have always bought an X. So in that case, you can just merge Y and X together. You don't have to carry it as a simple 2 different items. You can just have as YX. Okay. Another one is sub item set pruning. So if, as I told, if X is always in the transaction when Y is there, so we can just say support of X is equal to support of Y. So it's always, you can prune your tree so that the X descendants do not have to be there. Okay, so you can just take the remaining items from the tree. You can cut it off because it always holds true, right? I think I can show you that the frequent tree. Just 1 minute. know why it's taking such a long time. Okay, just think. We can just say P. Yeah, P is being kind of, or we can just say A. Okay, we'll just take A. So A is bought whenever XC is bought, right? So in that case, we can just like, you know, combine this here with C. Okay. So if a frequent item set X is a proper subset of an already found frequent closed item Y, and your support count of X is always equal to support count of Y, then X and all of X descendants in the set enumeration tree cannot be frequently closed items and thus can be pruned. You can just prune the tree. Okay. So, and then in the first depth mining for closed items at each level, there will be a prefix item set X, which is associated with the header table on a projected database. The local item has the same support in every header table at different levels. We can just safely prune that item from the header table at a higher level. So you can call it as skipping. Okay. So for example, you have a transaction where you have a, like, you know, a transaction database where minimum support is 2, and there's only 2 transactions. Okay, if a second transaction, the first transaction has the same support, then you can just, like, you know, prune that whole table. I'm just talking about, you know, using 2 different databases and trying to combine that. So you can just try to skip an item. Okay, so besides pruning the search space in the closed item mining process, another important optimization is to be performed, like efficient checking of each newly derived frequent item to see whether it is closed or not. So this is because the mining process cannot be ensured that every generated frequent item set is closed. Okay. And then you have to, like, you know, check your subset efficiently so that it checks if new frequent item set is a superset of already found closed item sets with the same support. And then let's discuss about how we can mine max patterns. Okay, so imagine you have a transaction ID and items here. In the first scan, we will find out the frequent items as A, B, C, D, E. Okay. And then the second scan, we'll just able to, like, find out the other patterns A, B, A, C, A, D, A, E, and A, B, C, D, E. B, C, B, D, B, E, B, C, D, E. C, D, C, E, C, D, E, and D, E. Okay. So through this, we'll be able to, like, you know, get this, and then we found out this is going to be our potential max patterns. If you're, like, finding out that, and then if BCDE is part of a max pattern, you don't have to check BCD, BDE, and CDE in a later scan because it's already there. Okay. So if you have able to, like, find out a maximum, a bigger pattern, you don't have to, like, look into the other things in a later scan. Okay, so that you will be able to, like, you know, mine a max pattern and you can just, like, you know, vomit the rest. I believe you are able to, like, you know, understand this. If you got any questions, you can ask right now.